I'm going to ask you, if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Luke chapter 2. If not, you can pull up our Greenbrier app and follow along right there. All the notes and all the scriptures will be right there for you. I am excited to be here with you today for a number of reasons. One is what Chuck just said, being able to fill in for him while they celebrate Megan graduated from Georgia Tech. I walked across that same stage 27 years ago, something like that. So I know what a special time that is. Georgia Tech, we don't say we graduated. We say we made it out. So I understand what they're going through this weekend. So I was glad to be able to allow them some time to celebrate that together. I'm also excited because this is bittersweet. It's the last time I'll be with you for a while. My ministry takes me away, and I won't be here for quite some time, but I will be back. So this will be the last message I get to bring to you for a little while. And probably most the reason I'm most excited to be here today is I get to preach about Christmas. And I don't get to do that very often. I'm a Christmas nut to begin with. I love Christmas, love everything about it. But in my line of ministry, I fill in for pastors. Not many pastors take time off at Christmas. It's just a busy time where a lot of things are laid out. So I don't get to preach a lot of Christmas messages. So I was really excited when Chuck called me a few months back and asked me if I would be a part of the series that he's doing. So I get to preach about Christmas today. I want to introduce you to a guy today in Scripture that's always, he's always kind of intrigued me. He's not even really in Scripture. We just kind of assume that he's in Scripture. There will be thousands of Christmas pageants over the next couple of weeks, and this guy will be in every one of them. He'll have lines. He'll have a very distinct personality, yet we don't know his name. We don't know if he's a man or a woman. We don't really even know if he existed. He usually has the very distinct personality of being kind of a crusty, greedy, heartless, very busy man. Can anybody guess who I'm talking about? The innkeeper, absolutely. The innkeeper from the Christmas story. Luke chapter 2, verse 7, kind of introduces us to this guy or girl or it, whatever it is. But let's look at Luke chapter 2, verse 7. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now you'll see there was no mention of an innkeeper there. And I think if there was an innkeeper there, he kind of gets a bum rap. I mean, we know him as this guy, that really mean old guy that wouldn't let Mary and Joseph come into his establishment. But I see him a little bit differently, and maybe that's because I can relate to him a little bit different than everybody else can relate to him, because I was at one time, believe this or not, sometimes I have trouble looking back on it and believing it, I was an innkeeper, believe it or not. When I got out of Georgia Tech and was looking for a job, took the first job that came along, and I got a job with this property management company, and for a couple of years I worked with them, and before too long I found myself managing a 23-room bed and breakfast inn. Now, to this day, it is still the most difficult job I ever had in my life, and I have had times in my life where I've been working three different jobs. Working one job as an innkeeper is without a doubt the most difficult work experience I've ever been through. Now, before we look at this guy, I guess the best way for me to start is kind of to describe what an inn was in that day, because we all have these different ideas of what an inn was. We read about one certain type of inn on ahead in Luke chapter 10, when Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. You all remember the story of the Good Samaritan. Jesus told the story that there was a guy going along the road, and he got beat up, and he got left on the side of the road, and the priest moved to the other side of the road so he didn't have to deal with him, and the Levite was too busy, and he couldn't take the time to deal with him. So the Samaritan came along, and the Samaritan helped the man. And in verse 34 it says, "So he went to him, and he bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and he set him on his own animal, and he brought him to an inn and took care of him." Now, it's interesting that the Greek word for inn right there in that scripture is the Greek word pandokian. Pandokian. And pandokian means a lodging place. That's what most of us think when we picture an inn in our mind, right? Some type of a lodging place. Maybe in our society today, we think of a Holiday Inn or we think of a Marriott or something along that line. But when we think about a place that has a room with some privacy and a moderate amount of comfort where we can kind of be alone with our thoughts and get some rest and get cleaned up and all that kind of stuff. But the word that's used in our scripture this morning in Luke chapter 2, verse 7, is not the same Greek word, pandokian. The word used in our scripture this morning for the word inn is the Greek word koupa. Koupa or koupa. Some people pronounce it koupa. Koupa. Koupa means a closet or a covering of some sort. The root word of that word actually means the breaking up of a journey. So here's what I want you to understand. Here's what I want you to wrap your mind around before we go any further. Where Mary and Joseph stopped that day, that night, was not at a Ritz-Carlton. It was not at a Marriott. It was not at an Econo Lodge. It was not even at a Motel 6. It is just some kind of a covering of some sort where you could remotely get away from the elements for just a little while and maybe with one eye open kind of lay your head down for a few minutes. Now, usually in ancient Israel, whenever you were traveling, and this is kind of obvious if you think about it, it would take longer than a day to get wherever you're going because they were walking. They were going by horseback or by mule or something like that. So these little places to dwell would crop up along the roadside because you didn't really need a motel for the night. You didn't need some place where you could stay for a 24, 48-hour period. You really just needed a place where you could rest, where you could water your animals, where you could lay your head down maybe just for a moment. You just needed this little koupa, this little place to lay your head and rest for a while. But what's happening on that night is Caesar Augustus has called for a census to be taken. And for the census to be taken, it meant everybody had to go back to their homeland, back to where their family line was from. So everybody whose family line came out of this little area called Bethlehem has now had to go back to Bethlehem. So this town has expanded overnight. And because it's this small town, there's not a lot of inns around. There's just this little koupa along the way where people would stop and they would lay their head for a little while and maybe stay for a couple of hours. But now people are staying for days and days in this place because they have to stay there for the census. And this is where Mary and Joseph were on that night. Probably some kind of little stopover for caravans on the way to Jerusalem to Galilee. Now, sometimes these structures didn't even have innkeepers. Sometimes these structures didn't have anybody looking out. It's kind of like if you're riding down I-20 and you come along to a rest area, right? Nobody's really taking care of the rest. There's nobody really there on site taking care of it. Somebody comes by and cleans it, I assume, that kind of stuff. But there's nobody there keeping the rest area. It's just a place where you can run in, get a little rest, get you some water, use the bathroom, whatever you need to do, and keep on your journey. That's kind of what we're talking about. Now, for the purpose of this message, because it all breaks down if we don't do this, let's assume there was an innkeeper, like we all like to, like every pageant assumes. Let's assume there was an innkeeper. Now, before we get deeper into the personal life applications, let's kind of set the stage for that night. I want you to understand, we've established this isn't very much of an inn, okay? This is just a little place along the road. And because of what we know about Bethlehem, we know that it's small and we know that it's lonely, so that we know that there was not many other places around for anybody to stop. And there wasn't for miles any more of these little stopping places along the road. And we find this little small establishment that used to only having a couple of people kind of laying down in it for a couple of hours, now full, it's jam-packed because everybody's supposed to go there. And this little town of Bethlehem, which is so small and so minuscule and so not even on anybody's mind, has now swelled with all these people, and now it's a hopping and a jumping place. It's kind of like what happened here Master's Week, right? We're just this little sleepy town, this little town of Augusta. Nobody would know us if it wasn't for that one week, right? But boy, that one week, does everything change. I mean, the town starts hopping. We become the place to be. There's people everywhere. That's what's happening in Bethlehem that night. And I have been an innkeeper during Master's Week. and it's brutal. In fact, I got out of the innkeeping business the Monday after Masters. I turned in my two-week resignation. I said, this is it. I'm done. I went through a 48-hour period where I never got to lay my head down. I was awake for 48 straight hours. It's chaos. It's people bidding on spare rooms, and rates are doubled and tripled. I remember we wouldn't have been able to survive the year if it wasn't for that 1 week. So I know what that innkeeper was going through that night. I understand what was happening. He was so full he didn't have any more space. You can be sure, first and foremost, that whatever visiting officials had come from Rome, that they got the first rooms. They got the first places to stay. They were going to be well taken care of. And they probably weren't even paying anything for the rooms. And then after that, everything else has been gobbled up by the people who have to return there for the census. And no doubt, Mary and Joseph are probably lagging behind everybody else. They're probably a little late getting into town than everybody else because she is, in fact, 9 months pregnant. So let's imagine the innkeeper is the way that I like to imagine the innkeeper. That he's a very nice guy who, bless his heart, is doing all he can to please everybody who's coming into his inn. And he says, I would love to help you guys. I feel so bad for you. I just don't have anywhere I can put you. Maybe even talk to some customers. And he said, hey, would you give up your space? Look, this poor couple, would you give up your space? And maybe nobody, there was no takers, nobody would give up their space. Or maybe he is kind of like the guy we portray in all the pageants. Maybe he's got no room, but he's making so much money. He's making enough money that he can retire on. And he says, you know what? I don't have a bed for you, but I got a barn out back. And I'll rent that barn to you if you can give me the right price. Maybe he is like that. Maybe he did have some room, but he decided he wanted somebody else to have it. I mean, he was trying to make as much cash as he could. You businessmen in here, you can understand what that guy was going through, right? He's got a chance. He's making it. Nobody ever stops at his place like this. And now he's making it. For those few days, he's making it. So who in the world was this dirty old carpenter and his pregnant wife coming in here asking for a room? They couldn't possibly have money to spend. The practical business decision would have been to wait for a wealthier traveler to come by. When I was managing my inn, be assured we weren't running a homeless shelter during Master's Week. I was going out and marketing it to corporations. I wasn't even giving it to just regular people. I wanted corporations to come in. You know why? Because corporations spend more money. They want everybody to be happy. They eat and drink, make sure everybody's well-fed and having a good time. Any of these things could have been true that night. Maybe simply he got one look at Mary about to pop, and he said, no way. Not happening here. I am not about to have all that mess going on here. I got enough to worry about tonight without having a baby be born in here. I got customers to think of. They don't want to hear the pain of childbirth going on all night. Nope, nope, nope. That stuff belongs out in a barn somewhere. And maybe he went, I don't know. Who knows? Whatever the case that night, could be one of these reasons, could be another. There was no room that night in the inn for Mary and Joseph. And as a result, the only place left was a stable. Now, I want to look at that for just a moment. I want us to see three observations about the innkeeper. And hey, listen, everybody else who was there that night, now, we're not going to pin all this on the poor innkeeper. Everybody had a chance to give up their room for the pregnant couple, and they didn't. Okay? So everybody who was there that night is culpable. I want to look at three observations about what was going on that night that may be true in our own lives this Christmas. First of all, I want you to see the innkeeper and all those other people there that night missed Jesus when he came knocking. They missed Jesus when he came knocking. Jesus ended up in a stable, and all those people missed him that night. How many times may it have happened in our lives that we have missed Jesus knocking on the door. Jesus with an opportunity for us, he knocks on the door and we miss it. Staying with the story, I think there's a few reasons that they missed Jesus that night. And again, it may be kind of true in our lives today if we're honest with ourselves. First of all, they missed Jesus because they were too busy. They were simply too busy to be bothered by the young couple. There were meals to prepare. No doubt there was family coming to town. There were family reunions going on. There was a census to prepare for. There were taxes to be paid. Some people were just passing through town. They were going to another town. They didn't have time to stop and deal with this. They had to get where they were going. So they were just trying to get their 20 winks. Let me ask you, and you be honest with yourself, do you think there was ever a time in your life where you were too busy to hear Jesus knocking? Be honest. I really think the biggest threat to someone who is truly and authentically trying to know God better is to be too busy. I read a recent survey where Christians around the world, 139 different countries participated in this survey of Christians, and 6 out of every 10 said they often or always let the business of life get in the way of their relationship with Jesus Christ. The author of the study made a fascinating observation about that I couldn't get past. That the busyness amongst believers leads to a dangerous, vicious cycle of conformity to the world. Let me share with you how he feels that happens. We live in a culture of busyness, of hurry and overload, and that leads us to God becoming more and more marginalized in our lives, which leads to a deteriorating relationship with God, which makes us more vulnerable to adopting the secular assumptions of life, which leads to more conformity and more overload, and the cycle begins again and again until God becomes an afterthought in our lives. Man, I bet it's staggering what we've missed out on because we were too busy to hear Jesus knock. I bet it's staggering if we could see it. Not even busy with bad stuff, busy with good stuff, but busy. We've got to carve out time to leave the chaos of life and just be still and be alone with God. We can't let busy take us away from being who God has called us to be. They were busy that night. They were full that night. Bethlehem was full that night. Bethlehem was too full for the young couple that night. We get so busy because our lives get so full, we miss Jesus. In John chapter 10, Jesus said that he came so that we could live life to the fullest, but not so that we could live lives that are full. We could live lives to the fullest, but not live lives that are full. To the world, living life to the fullest means stuff, right? Stuff, things, money. But Jesus talked about living life to the fullest to people who had nothing. So maybe to Jesus, living a full life is very different than the world's idea of a full life. Maybe to Jesus, a full life is a life that's filled with Him. It's not about stuff and things. It's not even about church and religion. It's about a grace greater than all our sin. It's about a love that knows no boundaries. It's about holiness. It's about a risen Savior. It's about the assurance of salvation. It's about a new life. That's the full life that Jesus is talking about. And when we fill with those things, that's when we're ready to hear Jesus knock at the door. God, forgive us when we fill our lives with the things that cause us to miss you knocking at our door. They were too busy that night. They were too full that night. They were too burdened that night. They were too burdened. Maybe somebody could have given up a bed for a pregnant woman, but there was this long trip ahead. They had already made a long trip. They had more to go. They had to get their rest. Then there would be the responsibility of maybe, heaven forbid, helping Joseph with the delivery. I mean, if you got involved, you had to be involved completely. Or maybe the innkeeper might have seen the expense of having a pregnant woman there. She would need oil and she would need clothes. And that stuff was costly, especially when taxes were being risen right there with the census. No, with all the census going on, it's just too costly to give up a room for this couple. Isn't that us? Sometimes, we being honest, answering Jesus' knock may be just a little too costly sometimes. It requires sacrifice, and the burdens of life are just too much to give up anymore. I can't share with that person, it'll take too much time. I can't sit and listen to that guy's problems, I got enough problems of my own. I can't tithe, I barely have enough to live on as it is. I can't be a part of a church, Sunday's my only day to sleep in. We let ourselves get too burdened, and we get into a place where we can't hear Jesus' knock, and we miss him. Having been in ministry now for over 20 years, but mostly from looking at my own life, you know what the truth is? Lots of times, we want to be burdened so we can't hear Jesus knock. Because deep down, we know Jesus told us to do two things. He said, first, follow him. And that's hard enough, right? But most of us here, we've measured that up and we said, okay, we're good with that. We'll follow you. But secondly, he threw something else in. He said, also go make disciples. And that's scary. And that's uncomfortable. And that's exhausting. So we'd rather be burdened with the things of life that we're more comfortable with and say, but I never heard Jesus knock. Because that's comfortable. And that's easy. And that's the way out. They were too busy. They were too full. They were too burdened. And that night, they were too self-absorbed. They were too self-absorbed. They were so focused on their own stinking needs, their own lives, their own busy, full, burdened lives that they missed the greatest birth in the history of mankind. They were so self-absorbed, so full, so busy that they missed Jesus knocking at the door. Listen, sin makes us self-centered, okay? When babies are born, they're born selfish. You have to be taught not to be selfish. So it's not just some small character flaw that a few of us had. We're all born and we're all drawn to being self-absorbed. It's a natural tendency. The paradox of that is that self-absorption goes against the very fabric of what Jesus is all about, but we have to lay aside self-centeredness and answer Jesus to be released of the burden of self-centeredness. Christ's model for us was very, very simple. He was so selfless that he allowed his body to be brutally nailed on a cross, not for his own sin, but for mine. There is truly no greater characteristic of Jesus to model than to love and to help others. Here's something. Some of y'all know I'm a high school coach. Here's something we do with our teams every point during a season. Every season, we will sit them down in a classroom, we'll give them a piece of paper, and we will ask them why they are doing what they're doing. In other words, if I'm working with my softball team, I'll say, why do you play softball? If I'm working with a basketball team, why do you play basketball? And I want you to look deep within. And generally, what their first answers are all completely selfish. Because I enjoy it. Because I want to be the best. Because I like this. Because I. And when we can get them out of being focused on I and being focused on a much bigger picture than just themselves, that's when we start to become a functioning team. You ever stop to analyze, as you look at your life, why you do what you do? Why do you do what you do? State your why for all the things that you do, and you'll be shocked how often your motivation is completely self-centered and all about me. Martin Luther once wrote this: if only I had been there, how quick I would have been to help the baby. I would have washed his linen. How happy I would have been to go with the shepherds to see the Lord laying in a manger. We say that because we know how great Christ is. But if we had been there at that time, we would have done no better than the people of Bethlehem. Why don't we do it now? Jesus knocked on the door, and they missed him. Secondly, I want you to see, the innkeeper and all those people there were used in God's divine plan. He still used them in his divine plan. Whether they knew it or not, whether they wanted to participate or not, they were still used in his divine. See, none of this caught God by surprise. God didn't go, whoa, wait a minute. You're supposed to take them in. That didn't happen. God knew this. They were all being used by God. Listen, let me ask you something. Would we worship Jesus the same way? And would we identify with Jesus the same way if Luke chapter 2 read like this? Mary and Joseph came into town, and Joseph's entourage went on ahead. They cleared the way and demanded that the top floor be evacuated and all those people sent out in the cold that night so Mary and Joseph could have some privacy. Mary had the baby, and they clothed him in the finest of linens and didn't allow anybody to come in and see him because they didn't want to be bothered that night. Would the story of Jesus be the same if that's how it went? No, it was God's divine plan that the baby be born in a stable, and unknowingly the people in the inn were used mightily by God that night, and they didn't even know it. And because they didn't hear Jesus knock, they couldn't enjoy the blessing that was unfolding right before their eyes. God's providence is always at work. See, I guess here's the best way to put it. God's always going to get his way. Okay? You can just choose whether you're going to be a part of it or not. You can be on the good side or the bad side, but God's going to get his way. I read the back of the book. I know how this thing ends. The inn that night was probably very full, very loud, very stuffy, very uncomfortable to be in, but they had a stable to themselves. You know what a stable was? You know, I know we look at our nativity scenes, we've got that pretty little thatch hut and all that kind of stuff. That's not generally what in ancient Israel that a stable was. A stable was generally a cave of some sort, something carved out of the rock. So they went into this stable, this cave, and it's a funny thing about caves. Caves never get too hot or too cold. They pretty much stay the same climate at all times. So instead of Mary and Joseph being in that stuffy, crowded inn, God put them in a climate-controlled private suite. God's providence is at work. They missed Jesus when he knocked. Yet they were still used in the divine plan. And third, they all missed a tremendous opportunity. They were so self-absorbed, they had no room for Jesus, and missed out on the greatest birth in all of eternity. They missed the opportunity to be at the Savior's birth because, honestly, they just really didn't care that it was going on. They had other things to be concerned with. In the book of Revelation, Jesus tells a church at Laodicea, they are neither hot nor cold, you're lukewarm. In other words, that's the worst thing you can be, is just kind of not caring. I wonder how many opportunities have been missed because we got lukewarm, because many times we've missed a blessing because we were too busy. How many times we were used and didn't even get to enjoy the blessing because we were so self-absorbed. How many times did Jesus knock on our door and we didn't answer the blessing that was standing there? I have a real good friend. His name is James. I've known James probably 25 years. 2013, I got an opportunity to hire James to work for me. It was a thrill to have him come work for me. I got to see him on a daily basis. Now, James works in a different area that I work in, so we don't spend all day together, but usually 2-3 times a week, James comes by my office at the end of the day, and he plops down in the chair, and James and I just talk. Talk about sports. We talk about life. We talk about the good old days. We talk about kids. Occasionally, we talk about God. He knows what I do. He knows I'm a pastor, but here's what I know about James. He hates church. He wants no part of church. All the old answers that I've gotten through all the years, hypocrites, you know, I don't need nobody telling me how to live. I've invited him so many times to come hear me, and he's made, yeah, maybe never shows up. But I love James. And I'm waiting for that opportunity that's coming, that where I can get to that final point and say, James, when you die, where are you going to be? I'm waiting for that point. I'm waiting for that opportunity. Waiting for the right moment for that to happen. Then I'm going to nail it. Friday after Thanksgiving, I was driving in my car and I got a phone call. And I saw it was a work number, so I answered it. I thought there must be an emergency going on at work. So I answered it, and it was a friend of mine from work, and he said, Scott James's wife just called. He died this morning. Massive heart attack. Before the paramedics could get to him, he was gone. And all I could think is, no way. First of all, James is one of the strongest guys I know. James had just lost a lot of weight, got himself into the greatest shape of his life. And I'm supposed to have a conversation with him. And I haven't had it. And I don't know whether it was fear that I didn't have that conversation, or knowing what I thought the answer was going to be if I had that conversation. But James died. I never had the conversation with my friend. Now, over the days and weeks since then, I've done a lot of contemplating. I've come closer and closer to Calvinism, that God's going to save who he's going to save, and you got nothing to do with it. I don't want to get into that big theological loop by any means. And I don't think God would use my disobedience to not bring someone to himself that he wants. Okay? Well, here's what I do know. If God brought James to himself, I lost the opportunity to be a part of that blessing. I lost the opportunity to be able to walk up to his wife at a funeral and say, you may not know this, but in my office, James made a decision. And I know where James is right now. I was not able to tell her that. Chuck has been talking to you for the last few weeks about living fearlessly this Christmas. Zechariah and Elizabeth, Mary, Joseph, showed us how they all lived fearlessly. He's challenged us to live fearlessly this Christmas. I just introduced you to a bunch of people who we don't even know their names, and we don't even know if they existed because they refused to live that way. I can't think of any way I'd less like to be remembered than I don't even know if that guy existed. Do you want that to be your legacy? We don't even know if they existed. Someday they'll be talking about the history of Greenbrier Church. The last thing I want them to say is we're not even sure they really existed because they left no impact. Will you live fearlessly for Jesus this Christmas, at Christmas where everybody is so receptive to the story? Don't miss the opportunities that come knocking at your door. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to come and speak to this body. Father, I confess to you my fearfulness that kept my tongue tied for so many years. Father, would you release us from that? Would you give us a strength beyond what we know that we have? Father, you gave us a command. You said, follow me and then go make disciples. Forgive us where we've fallen short on that second one. Father, give us the words to say and the opportunities to say them. Let us be so sensitive to be able to hear your knock at the door. Father, I praise you. I thank you for this time of year. Father, I thank you for what it does in our hearts, what it does in the lost hearts, that it stirs us and it softens us and it makes us ready. Father, we thank you and we praise you. In Christ's name, amen.